Hey, everybody. Woo-wee. Welcome back to the Bowfishing Buzz, episode 92.
There we go. That's what I'm talking about.
Wow. Brought to you by AMS Bowfishing and
Megamouth Bowfishing as well. Sponsored by Efficiency Bowfishing Lights by Outdoor Innovations USA and Designs Leatherwork and Embroidery. We are back in the booth for our November podcast. We could not be more excited.
That's right. That's right. Over yonder, I've got DD the man, D. Schmitty
is here and in the house. Yes, sir.
My name is Mathew, and thanks for joining us.
Absolutely. Yep, a little pre-Thanksgiving, the week before our Wisconsin rifle season starts.
This is like the biggest holiday in the state of Wisconsin.
It is. And just to throw it in here.
The old Orange Army, baby.
I was thinking about this the other night, Matt. Okay, this time of year, I'm just going to lay these out in a list here. One, it's my favorite time of year for the weather. Like, give me a high of 40, low of 25. Yep. I love that weather up here. It's deer season. It's been archery season. Rifle season is around the corner. Yeah. All right. Thanksgiving is close. Christmas is right around the corner. We've got basketball on. The Packers are beating the Bears. We got all kinds of things going on this time of year. It's just a splendid.
Yes, it is.
Splendid time of year. And just a little side note here. I don't know if you know, Matt, but I was actually successful in securing a victory in my previous week's fantasy football matchup. So that was pretty cool. Pretty cool.
Why did I screw that up? Man, did I screw that up.
The Super Lamarios took down the Midway Misfits this past week. thanks to Russell Wilson, or as I've been hearing him called, Rusty Wilson, because that was kind of rough.
We won't talk about that.
Yeah. I don't mean to bring up bad intentions here, but it is what it is.
Yeah. So. Yep. Well, Schmitty, on your last podcast, we talked about you having success.
Yes. Yep.
Archery season this year. Shot a wonderful looking deer.
Yep.
Beautiful 10 point.
Yep. 11. But who's counting?
Is it 11? Okay. I got lucky.
You had a very interesting situation layout.
This is one of the hunting stories that you tell and people aren't going to believe you. Aren't going to believe you.
I experienced it through texting like as it happened. So it is 100% true. So, Matt, why don't you dive into detail about that special November 4th
afternoon. Oh, my gosh. So it was a Monday. Yep. I was off that whole week for rutcation.
I think wasn't that like your first day of rutcation starting?
Well, Friday was that I was using vacation days for, but I hunted the Friday, Saturday, and Sunday leading up to Monday.
Yep.
Saw some decent bucks, nothing close enough, but saw some nice rutting action and chasing and grunting and all that stuff. Good time. But then our weather really took a change.
I remember that I sat with Corey. He works here at AMS, does a lot of the machine work. Great job. I sat with him Friday morning, and Friday morning, November 1st, was it was your typical beautiful 1st of November. It was it was chilly, frost on the ground, and like you said, we saw some good movement. We didn't see anything that was a shooter, but we had some good movement on Friday. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Monday, I'm up in my stand in the dark, and as I'm driving to the woods, I should say back up, but when I'm driving to the woods, it's foggy out. There's fog everywhere in the hollows and in the fields and stuff, and it's warm.
I was going to say, weren't the highs like 60s? Yeah. Low 60s that day?
It was warm. It's drizzling. Yeah. It's a haze. It's heavy. The air is heavy. And I went and sat in my morning spot. Wasn't seeing nothing there. Went and moved to a different spot. A little bit of a, where they're transitioning between bedding and feeding. Sure. I went and sat in there a little bit. As I'm sitting there, I got a picture of a deer crossing one of my food plots, crossing the road, one of my favorite spots. And that was at 11 o'clock in the morning.
Okay. Oh, midday movement.
And then I got another picture at 1 o'clock of another deer crossing, going across there.
Yep. And you texted me those pictures.
Yes.
You said, I should have been sitting in this other plot.
And one of the deer is one that I've had on camera. I've got video of him. You know, I knew who he was. But the wind was not right. The wind was out of the east with that stupid, goofy weather and stuff.
Yep.
And I looked at the weather, and I'll be darned, it was making a switch out of the west at around 2 o'clock.
Yep.
So at 2 o'clock, at 1:30, I still wasn't seeing nothing at all for deer. Decided to head down and go over and sit in my road plot.
Because I remember I texted you. I said, based off those pictures, Matt, you got to move. Right. And your text back was, I'm already there.
Right.
I'm already moved to that spot.
Yep. And so I got into there about 10 after 2 or so. And I'm sitting there, and I'm not expecting much with the weather or anything, you know.
Yep.
And I'm actually sitting back. I can't see the sides. All I can see is in front of me because my walls, it's a pallet blind, and I painted them black.
Sure.
And I can't see out of them.
Yep.
So I'm sitting back in there, and I'm playing card games. I'm playing Sheephead on my phone.
What an old man thing to play on your phone. Card games. Okay.
I'm playing Sheephead. And my back was getting sore, so I actually, like, reached out and kind of, like, stretched my back. Mm-hmm. And literally, I look, and all I see is a head and antlers walking towards the corner of my blind. And I snuck back into, you know, I pulled my head back, and I'm like, oh, my gosh, where is he going to go? He's walking right, he's going to walk into my pallet blind here. And I can't see nothing now, and I'm already with the bow. And I'm thinking he's not going to walk behind me because there's a cut cornfield. He's not going to walk back there.
Yep.
All of a sudden, I could hear him breathing.
and like, also, a wet, rained-on woods, he's not making a sound coming in.
But I can hear...
Oh, my gosh.
I can hear that.
Yep.
And all of a sudden, antlers appear right in front of my window.
That's insane.
And then here's his whole body. I can literally see... The deer's eyelashes.
That's too close. It's too close.
I can see his eyeballs.
So at this point, Matt, how far from you? How far from you is the deer?
2 feet.
So he's scraping up against your blind.
Yeah. I could have literally reached out and grabbed his G2 with my hand.
Wow.
And I'm like, oh my gosh. What am I gonna do?
Yeah. Yeah.
So his head got just past me, and I drew, and I actually had to stand up out of my chair because I couldn't shoot over my boards that were there.
Yep.
And I put the pin on his front chest, and I squeezed the trigger.
And?
I missed.
They don't make a one-yard pin on those sights. So
and all the commotion and stuff, I didn't realize I had a really, you know, drop on that.
Sure, yep.
And I shot right over his back.
Yep.
And he took off. And as soon as he was gone, I never heard a sound.
Yeah.
Never heard a sound. I'm like, mm-hmm. What the heck? But I went out there and I got my arrow and it was stuck into a tree. I had to unscrew my broadhead, my arrow from
just
the tree.
Buried
and
buried it.
There's my broadhead.
You
in
killed
the tree.
That maple tree.
Did. Yeah. And I went back in and knocked another arrow and I was sitting there and I'm like, what the heck just happened?
Yeah.
I wasn't really mad. I was like, that was freaking cool.
Yeah, that's crazy experience to be that close.
I'm like, you got to be kidding me.
What if you wouldn't have stretched your back? You'd have first seen that deer when he was like a foot in front of you. scared the hell out of you.
It would have.
Oh, my gosh.
So now I didn't know where this deer went.
Yep.
All right, so I'm like.
And you just went out. You just left the blind to go grab your arrow.
Yep.
Yep.
Came back in. And like 2 minutes later, I had a buck fawn walking the same path. Right. I'm like, man, that's too close for comfort.
Yeah.
So I texted my wife and I told her the whole situation and stuff. And then it was, I knew you had to work till 3:30 and I texted you and you responded back around 3:40.
Yep. Right when I left work. Yeah.
And you said, what?
Yeah. You said, I just missed.
Yes.
And I said, oh, I said, really? What the hell? What happened?
Yeah. Yep. And so I'm sitting there and I have my bow resting. I'm holding onto the riser with my left hand and I got it on my knee. So I'm ready.
Yep.
You know? And I'm literally texting you the story of what just happened.
Yeah.
And literally, I looked up, and all I could see was antlers coming from across the road, and he's walking through my food plot.
Yep.
I put the phone between my legs. I drew back. He got right to the center where I wanted him, and he stopped completely broadside. And he took off running into the woods. And I texted you, and it says, I just shot him.
Yeah. Yeah. The series of text messages was the most confusing thing I've ever heard in my life.
Yeah.
You said, you texted me, you said, you got to be kidding me. I said, what happened? He goes, I just missed.
Yeah.
I'm like, oh, man. I said something like, oh, man, that's too bad. You never know what's going to happen, you know, whatever. Next snap, I need you to come out here. I'm like, why? He goes, I just hit one. I'm like, what? You just missed one. What's going on here? Yeah, that was wild.
At this time, I thought this deer was a different buck that I had just shot him. Okay?
Yeah. Yeah.
So, my deer took off right in the woods.
And you, from what you could tell, you hit him hard.
I hit him good.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yep. Hit him good. And it started to rain.
Oh,
it started to rain pretty good.
Scary.
Yes. So you're like, give me 20 minutes. I got to go home and change and get ready. So, okay. Well, I got to start seeing where some blood is here.
Yeah.
So I can see where it went into the woods and whatnot. So I went out on the phone. Couldn't find my arrow. And found blood. But it's raining pretty good.
Yeah.
I'm like, man. So I just kept... I kept having blood, so I kept going on it. And pretty soon I could see it was coming out both sides.
Yep. And you were sending me pictures to the blood trail.
Yep, you can see bubbles in what was on the leaves from the blood.
Yep.
But it was not lasting very long from the rain hitting it. But then I could tell more was coming out. And then I looked a little bit in front of me, and I could see them piled up there.
Yeah.
And then you came out there, and we went back to the shot where I hit him, and there laid my arrow
on top of the weeds. Yeah, yep.
I found my arrow sitting right there, and then, like I said, he probably went, 35?
I was going to say 40 yards.
45 yards.
Yeah.
Yep. Yep. 10 ringed him. Nice little broadhead marks right through his heart.
The old G5 dead meat just tore him up.
Yeah.
Yeah. And I know this was selfish of me. I hate to admit this.
He did not want me to.
But as you were, and I understand, it's raining. You got to try to get on blood. But as I was driving over there, you were sending me pictures. And you'd send me pictures, a little bit of blood. And then the next picture was blood on, you could tell he was bleeding out both sides. And I'm like, oh. In my head, I'm like,
don't find him.
I hope he finds him. But at the same time, I want to help him find the blood trail. And then you sent me a picture of the deer. And I'm like, no, yes.
Because when you got there, we actually didn't go to the deer. We went to where I shot him. Yep. And you wanted to follow the blood trail too.
We found the arrow. And I mean, the deer, obviously you'd have found that deer. He didn't go far, but there was almost no blood to go off of just from the 20 minutes of rain.
Yep.
And it was not like a pouring rain, but it was a solid rain.
Yeah.
That really washed that blood away fast.
It does. It does.
Yeah. Yep. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. But just, I mean, it was a beautiful deer, man. Yep.
And smoked them. And here it ended up being the same one that I missed just a little bit ago.
That's the craziest part of this story.
I don't know how he went back around on the other side of the road.
Yeah. Yeah. to me, you just have to chalk that up to that deer was so, for lack of a better term, horny, that he had this crazy thing happen to him where when you missed him, he had no idea what happened. This wild commotion happen, but he didn't know what happened.
No, he had no idea what happened.
And it's like he just reset himself and continued doing what he had in mind to do.
Yep, yep.
Yeah.
And I didn't know it, but after I shot him and he took off, then a doe was behind him, which is
that's weird itself.
Yeah. There was a doe behind him that took off running too. But yeah, crazy. Just a crazy hunting story.
It's awesome. and a beautiful deer, Matt. I mean, a solid deer. Yeah. It was just awesome. Yeah. And when we gutted him, we pulled the heart out. And you could literally see the triangle of that dead meat going through that heart. Mm-hmm. I mean, you couldn't have gone up to that deer and poked him in the heart any better than what you shot him. It was awesome. That spot there is so cool. It's a spot that a lot of guys would overlook.
Oh,
but it's spectacular. Derek,
it took me... Since I started hunting that property, it took me five years before I was like, you know, you I ain't hunting by the road.
Oh yeah, that's I'm
not hunting by the road.
Yeah, cars going by, people walking through.
Now, let me use this so that you can use this for bow fishing.
Mm.
What I'm hunting right there is a hard pinch point. Yep. It's an extreme funnel pinch point. I was sitting there thinking in my stand, I'm like, you know, how we also use pinch points and funnels for bow fishing.
Oh, absolutely. Yep. Bottleneck those fish.
Bottlenecks.
Yep.
Exactly.
Yep.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Especially when they're going from a lake back into a bay or a cove.
Yep.
And they're spawning.
Mm-hmm.
Oh.
Buckle in.
Oh, hang on.
Yeah.
Yep. We did that last year. You actually got out of the boat and stood on the shore.
Oh, yes. That's your perfect example right there. That was wild. I think every fish coming into that bay was coming around that point right there. Yeah, and we couldn't get to it with the boat, so we hopped out and shot them from shore.
Yep, and it was just one after another.
Yep, it was.
They smell the
pheromones.
Pheromones.
Yes. That water gets to smell real good. Oh, we got the old snortlies coming into play.
Yeah. I wonder how carp grunt.
Get over here, baby.
Come here, baby.
Yeah.
Come here, baby. Let me rub you.
Yeah, let me push on your sides, big fat girl.
little ayu chihuahua.
Exactly. Yes, yes. I chihuahua. That's exactly what that buck had on his mind, yeah, too.
Right.
But, yeah, that was right. Very cool. And the fact that it was the same deer coming through there, just wild. You might never have that type of situation play out again in your life.
No, no. I'll never, you know? I'll never be that close to a 3.5-year-old buck in my life.
Yeah, yeah. Mm-hmm. You know, just on the hunting front here, Matt, it is a tradition weekend coming up here in Wisconsin. We have our 9-day rifle season coming into play here starting this Saturday.
Yeah.
That'll run for 9 days. The Orange Army will get into the woods. It's such a tradition up here. The amount of hunters that hit the woods this time of year, especially in Wisconsin, right. You know, you've got your pressured states, Wisconsin, Pennsylvania, Michigan. There's gonna be a lot of people in the woods this weekend. It's a great thing. Guys are getting outdoors. But, you know, I think a lot of guys that share that trophy mentality of chasing mature deer have a little bit of a bittersweet feel to the rifle season coming into play. At least I know that that I do. Mm-hmm. I for sure do. Yeah. I shouldn't. That's selfish. I need to work on not letting that get to me as much, but I haven't quite gotten over the hill yet.
I'm a deer hunter. How do you do?
Exactly. We played at the shop yesterday.
Yep. I got the great big knife, and the hunting is my life.
Mm-hmm.
The turkey. I love to freeze my buns chasing trophy deer. But don't clap your hands to the clapping of the beat, because, yeah, he's like me. He can't keep a steady beat.
Yes.
Or something like that.
The old 30-point buck song.
So if
we should make that into a bowfishing song.
Yes.
I'm going to shoot that 60-pound
So that
buck.
Song where we played, I don't know how many times, Saturday morning, hunters are driving through the woods.
And Friday night.
For those of you who do not know.
Yeah, probably no one knows what we're talking about.
Search the 30-pointer.
And not the and 30.
No.
It's the 30.
The 30-point buck.
D-A-T-U-R-D-Y.
Right.
Point buck.
By the bananas. I think it's the bananas at large.
Okay. I know yesterday when I looked it up, it's got like 181 million listens.
And played. It's a Wisconsin tradition. Yes. Did you see the 30-pointer? Did you see the 30-pointer?
Yep. Yeah.
I'm going to get that 30-point buck.
Yep. It'll make a little bit more sense once you listen to it, what we're talking about here. But, yeah, that's rolling in this weekend. I wish everybody out in the woods a safe and successful hunt.
Yeah.
We'll be out partaking in it as well, Matt.
Yep, for sure.
But also, you've been, your wife Julie's been out in the woods too a little bit, huh?
Yeah. Yep. I've been sitting with her. So when I shot mine, I've been sitting with her, and we have not had much luck, but she's still going at it, you know.
That's cool that she hunts. That's
awesome. We actually went out this past Saturday and Sunday, and did not choose the right stand on Sunday afternoon after I got my pictures from my West food plot. We sat in the wrong spot.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's hunting for you there. That's just wild.
Mm-hmm.
But what do you do?
What do you do? Right. Hopefully that saw just a really nice 10, wide 10. Didn't have much for tines, but he had a couple of nice on his left side. But hopefully she gets a crack at him or my dad.
Yeah, absolutely.
My dad's 85 years old, and we just went out this past weekend and moved his little wagon blind, brought it back in a little bit different spot for him. So 85 years old, I love it. He's out there. We went out and sighted our guns in on Saturday morning together, and I love hunting with my dad.
Yep.
You know, we actually called him, and he came out
when you shot
mine.
Deer. Yep.
And
yep.
He came out and helped.
You were out and stuff. You were cleaning something up, your knife or something, and we were in your little area where you're pulling to park. And I've got a system down for loading bucks into a back of a truck.
Yeah.
Like a one-man system that actually works ridiculously well just over the years of doing that. So I hop up in the back, Matt, you were cleaning something up, and I grabbed that deer, and Leroy, he jumped right in there, and he's putting that buck up under his shoulders and lifted up. I'm like, hell yeah, dude, that's awesome. Yeah. 85 years old, he's not missing out on nothing.
No, it's awesome hunting with Dad.
Yeah, yeah. Well, we've got a very interesting podcast.
Yes,
here,
we
Matt.
Do, Schmitty.
We kind of thought of this idea a week or two ago.
Yep.
And I'm very curious to see how it all lays out, because we like to gather as much information from a bunch of different people in different areas as we can, just because, you know, we're up here in Wisconsin, but there are so many opportunities, obviously, all around the United States. So what we're going to be doing today is we're going to be calling three guests, all right? We're going to get Tommy Woods, Dennis Redden, and Lance Brantley, all very well-known bow fishermen in the bow fishing industry. We're just going to discuss with them how their 2024 season was compared to their 2023 season, kind of like a year in review type of deal. We're going to talk about bucket list fish, and we're also going to pin them down, and we're going to ask them if they could only hunt one day a year, what state, what would the date be, and what fish would they be targeting?
Yeah.
So we're gonna get some interesting details out of these guys. I think it'll be an interesting podcast just to see where everyone is as far as what their goals are and any trends throughout this 2024 bow fishing season.
I can tell you have hunting on your mind.
Why? What? Did I say something wrong?
Yeah, you just said, we're going to ask them if they had one day to hunt, one day
I'm sorry. if they had one day to bow fish, what date, what state, and what species would they be targeting? Yep. I do have hunting on the brain. Good correction. Yep.
Good stuff right there. So, yeah, I'm looking forward to getting those guys on, talking with them, seeing how their season is going, how their season is ending, what they're looking forward to next year, all that cool stuff. So, moving on, Schmitty, what does the word invasive mean to you?
Invasive. Well, I'll tell you what, we've got the correct answer here, but I'm just going to freeball here and give you my invasive meaning. Mm-hmm. My invasive meaning would be bringing something in that is not native with the thoughts of it being somewhat beneficial to the ecosystem, and it totally backfires. And pretty soon these invasive species are now the dominant species and they're taking over native game fish habitat. Mm-hmm. All right, so that's what I would say without reading the notes here.
Yeah.
The meaning here, what does invasive mean and what are the effects of invasive species? Why are they harmful? Invasive fish, plants, and other species can lead to the extinction of native species, destroy biodiversity, and permanently alter habitats through both direct and indirect effects. Mm-hmm. And most of the time, those indirect effects are the things that are not thought of when these invasive species are brought in.
Right.
They're not all the research gets done, and pretty soon something that you didn't think of is backfiring big time.
Right. Yeah. The last couple of years, we've had these beetles.
Japanese beetles.
That have just taken over in the fall. It is eating all of our apple trees and our flowers and our flower gardens and creating havoc. My raspberries, he just attacked the shit out of my raspberries. Mm-hmm.
They're like three times the size of a ladybug.
Yeah.
And they're black and with little green markings on them. They're very strange looking bugs.
Yeah. Beetles. My chickens love them, but my plants hate them.
Yeah. Yeah, I bet.
Oh, yep. It's a mess. And then ladybugs. And so it's just not fish, plants.
Right. Oh, absolutely. Absolutely. One of the things up north, just in the fishing realm of things, I think it's called Eurasian milfoil, really takes over. There's a couple little lakes up north that used to be great fisheries. They're not anymore because they're choked out with that. Yep.
Mm-hmm. Yep. Mm-hmm. So we're going to look at one invasive species here today, the northern snakehead. Uh-huh. Schmitty.
Oh, interesting. Okay.
Bucket list for me.
Yes. I know you've said that before. Mm-hmm. They're a very interesting species. Mm-hmm.
Now, the northern snakehead, originating from China, Russia, and Korea, snakeheads are a tough, hardy fish at the top of the food chain that lack natural predators in introduced locations. Mm-hmm. Four species of snakehead fish have been introduced into the United States, and the northern snakehead has established a breeding population in the wild. Mm,
bad, bad, bad.
Snakeheads can breathe air and can live out of the water for up to 4 days, provided it is wet. Because they will eat anything from fish, frogs, and crustaceans to small insects, they can cause significant disruptions in the ecosystem. They enter the native species, often lose. Oh, I'm sorry here. I had a cough here. My eyes started watering. I couldn't
see they're watering over there.
Because they can cause significant disruptions in any ecosystem they enter, and native species often lose out to this predator. Mm-hmm. The damage they've done is extensive. Since 2002, it is illegal to possess a live snakehead in the United States.
Yeah. Yep. That just shows the invasiveness of them. You're not allowed to have one that's alive.
Wow.
That's insane. Northern snakeheads were likely introduced to the United States through a combination of aquarium dumpings, accidental releases, and intentional releases from fish markets. Kind of your same type of story that we always hear with these invasive fish. Aquarium dumping. Some people intentionally released snakeheads from their aquariums because they were expensive to feed and outgrew their tanks. Live food fish markets. Snakeheads were imported to supply the growing live food fish trade. Illegal stocking. Some snakeheads were illegally stocked into natural waters. Sport fish culture. Some people introduce snakeheads for culture for something to
sport. Isn't that crazy?
Fish. Yeah. That's bad.
Yeah, that's not good. This is an interesting one here, Schmitty.
Yeah, so I've got prayer animal release. Some cultures practice prayer animal release.
Wow.
I don't even know what that even entails.
I'm guessing that has something to do with
they're like a religion type of fish type of deal.
Yes.
Interesting.
Yeah.
So they're highly sought after and thought of highly in...
it could be playing the Ouija board at the same time.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, interesting. Okay.
Crazy.
Yeah, yeah.
The size, northern snakeheads can exceed 33 inches in length and can weigh up to 19 pounds.
It's a solid fish.
Yeah.
It's a solid fish. Habitat. Snakehead fish prefer to live in shallow ponds, swamps, and slow-moving streams that have a lot of plants and muddy surfaces. They can also be found in canals, reservoirs, lakes, and rivers. So pretty much anywhere.
Pretty much.
Pretty much. If there's water.
They're living
there. If you got a puddle in your front yard, check it for snakeheads.
Yeah.
Well, the optimal temperature range for northern snakeheads is 41 to 60 degrees Fahrenheit. They can tolerate temperatures as low as 32 degrees and greater than 86.
So that's a huge,
wide range. Yeah. Their ability to adjust to various depths, temperatures, and oxygen levels allows them to survive in many different types of aquatic environments. Northern snakeheads can also enter torpor, a state of inactivity, which allows them to survive in a very low temperature and even under the ice.
Yes.
Wow. Wow.
So they must go into like a little bit of a stage of hibernation, like hibernating.
Yep. Yep. A slight state of hibernation.
Where their heart
slows down. They don't have to feed.
They're not circulating a lot of blood. Yep. They're just like a turtle, I'm guessing, and frogs and stuff like
that. That portion of it right there, the wide ranges of where they can live, down to 32 degrees.
Yeah.
And obviously water, if you have 2 feet of ice, the water underneath the 2 feet of ice is 32 degrees and higher.
Right.
So they can live where it's, you know, they've got all kinds of areas that they can thrive
in. Unreal. Northern snakeheads are aggressive, carnivorous fish with dagger-like teeth. Mm. You ever see those pictures of those guys holding those out and you can see their teeth?
Yep. They're nasty looking.
Yep. Freshly hatched fry food or zooplankton and later small insects and crustaceans, juveniles eat small fish, while adults can eat fish that are up to 33% of their own body length.
Wow.
Wow. That's such as bream and carp, Schmitty. Adults will also eat dragonfly larvae, beetles, and frogs. So they're... they don't care what they're eating.
Let me put this into context. Matt, how tall are you?
6'2".
You're 6'2". How much do you weigh?
275.
275. Just for what we're doing here, we're just going to round that up to 300, even though obviously you're not there. So you're 6'2", 6 feet.
I might be at for Thanksgiving.
So let's say you're 6 feet tall and you weigh 300 pounds, which is not quite accurate, but it's close. Could you imagine yourself eating something that was 2 feet tall and it weighed 100 pounds?
Yeah.
That's what these fish are eating in scale.
Mm.
33% of their size and body length and weight.
Yeah.
That's insane.
And they don't care what it is that's going down their gullet.
No, they're just looking to feed on something. That's crazy.
Wow.
In their native habitats, northern snakeheads reach sexual maturity when they are 2 to 3 years old. I think carp are also the same.
Yeah.
I think they're even less. Carp are even less than that even. In places where they have been introduced, they may reach sexual maturity after only 1 year. Yeah, there we go. Spawning typically begins at the end of April and continues through August. That is a wide range of spawning as well.
Wait till you read this next one.
A single snakehead may spawn up to 5 times each year, releasing up to 1,500 eggs each time. Their eggs can hatch within 3 days.
Wow.
Holy cow.
Mm.
That's, yeah. They're invasive.
About 5 times a year they can
respond. Good Lord.
And another thing, Derek, that I didn't add to this here was, unlike carp or buffs or, you know, other, when they go into spawn and they release their eggs and stuff, they leave. They take off.
Right. The female doesn't have eggs anymore to dispense.
Snakeheads will stay with their fry and juveniles to help protect them.
Yeah.
Yep. So they don't get attacked by other critters and frogs and stuff.
So I would
assume
that success rate of those fry is a lot higher. They've got a 2 foot protector at all times.
Right.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yep. That's wild. Mm-hmm. That's wild. Mm-hmm. Well, these northern snakeheads, I definitely learned something here, Matt. I didn't. I knew they were bad. I knew they're invasive. I know there's a lot of guys out there that are shooting them, bowfishing, shooting snakeheads.
Oh, yeah.
Very cool to see that. They're a cool fish to go shoot, but they're bad news for local waterways.
One big plus on the snakeheads, as far as them being in the waters, is they're very good to eat.
Yes.
Makes great table fare.
Yep. I know we got a guy that I see a lot that's shooting snakehead, and they'll show a picture on their Instagram. It'll be of the snakehead, and the next picture will be of a fried piece of fish.
Yep.
They fry them right up. That's cool.
That's good stuff.
We should go shoot some and fry them up and make a whole episode out of it.
I'd rather do that.
Yeah, that'd be awesome. Out there on the East Coast somewhere.
So there's a little bit of information on the invasive snakeheads, how they got here, their habitats, their size, what they eat on, why they're invasive. Mm-hmm. So.
Yeah, very cool. Yeah. Very cool. Well, I'll tell you what, Matt, let's get that phone handy. Let's give these guys a call, like we talked about earlier. Tommy Woods, Dennis Redden, Lance Brantley. Let's see what they have to say after this quick commercial break.
We don't have any BAA records.
No, no records.
Boom, commercial break, and we're going to give these guys a call.
Yes, sir. Are you looking to elevate your bowfishing brand with stunning design solutions? Look no further than End Designs. Their team of talented designers is dedicated to bringing your vision to life. Whether it's t-shirts, hats, leather products, eye-catching logos, to captivating boat wraps, they have you covered. Plus, with their commitment to excellence and attention to detail, you can trust that your project is in good hands. Don't settle for ordinary. Choose End Designs for extraordinary results. Visit their website today and let's bring your ideas to life. End Designs, where creativity meets excellence. Efficiency Bowfishing Lights by Outdoor Innovations USA. A color tone adjustable and dimmable light with a unique patented reflector design that puts more light where you need it. Efficiency Bowfishing Lights offer three different models: the 65 watt single color economy light, the 65 watt Efficiency V2 tri-color dimmable light for maximum efficiency and versatility, and the 130 watt Efficiency Maximus, designed to be an all-out beast of a bowfishing light. Efficiency, designed and built by bowfishermen for bowfishermen. Check them out at OutdoorInnovationsUSA.com.
Hey, Tommy, this is Mathew and Derek calling from the Bowfishing Buzz. What's going on south today?
Just raining.
Raining. Yeah. That seems
makes it good for going looking at John.
Yeah, right.
Right. Yeah, we got a lot of rain up here, too. The whole country seems to be kind of in a rainy spell here.
Right.
Yeah. Yeah. Well,
first of all, Tommy, thank you, very much for joining us on the Bowfishing Buzz podcast. We appreciate that. We know you're a busy guy and staying active down there right now, especially this time of year with, the deer hunting and all that stuff going on. And then you have any luck this year, Tommy, with the old bucks down there that you're chasing?
Yes, sir. We just got back from Kansas this past weekend, and nice. We had 6 out of 7 kill.
Oh my gosh.
Up there. So we daggum had an extremely good year. We had one in the 190s. We had one in the 70s, couple in the 50s, and we had a really good year.
Oh my goodness.
I would say so. Holy cow. That was not what I was expecting from that.
Wow.
That's awesome. Wow. Congratulations. That's very cool.
Now, let me ask you this, Tommy. I was doing some reading before the season started here, and they were saying that a lot of the whitetail bucks could have better racks this year due to the mild winter that we kind of had last year and stuff. Yep. And you said you were in Kansas, correct?
Yep.
So do you think that had any factor on some of those deer having bigger racks? Was it an easier winter down in Kansas for those deer?
Yeah, they've had a pretty mild winter the past couple of years too. But I always had heard that the dry years were worse on the racks, but it was an extremely dry year this year, and it seems like there was a – so obviously what I heard wasn't that great, but right. That's what I've always heard. I've always heard that the wetter years were a little better, but it was extremely dry up there this year.
Oh, that's interesting.
It is. Well, congratulations on some studs.
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
Wow.
Absolutely.
Wow. I heard
– it was good years.
I also heard that EHD can really affect the deer when it's dry.
I was going to say those dry years, yeah.
Like that also. Yeah. You didn't have anything like that, did you? Hopefully not.
We've had that lease up there for over 16 years, and we're right on the river, so I don't guess we have ever seen a breakout. If we have, it must have been mild, but, I've been in Illinois before and hadn't been up there when they've had it, and I mean, dead deer everywhere close to the creeks, rivers, waters, all that stuff. But up there, we haven't never seen any sign of it. But I ain't saying that it couldn't be there, but we just haven't. We've been lucky enough, I guess, to not experience that
right
up there.
Yeah, right. Yeah, I've seen videos and whatnot on it, and it looks terrible. We've never really had it up here, but in that river bottom land, you'll see videos of guys just walking up on dead buck after dead buck. It just, that's awful.
Yeah,
awful stuff.
Yeah. Yep. Oh, yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. That's for sure.
Yep. So what we're doing here, Tommy, thank you again for joining us. We're giving a couple different people a call here, and we're just going to run you through like a rapid fire circuit of questions, kind of like a 2024 season in review, and just see if there's any trends or anything that kind of go along with all of the guests that we're going to be calling here today. Yep. My first question for you is, compared to the 2023 season, would you say that bow fishing was better or worse in 2024? And why would you think that it was better or worse?
Well, in our aspect, I don't know that we had a tremendous amount of difference that I've seen in other. I know the economy daggum took a lot of toll on as far as fuel prices and stuff like that, yep, traveling to the bigger tournaments and stuff. But I don't know. I don't think that in our eye there wasn't a tremendous – I didn't see any tremendous amount of big change. Now, we did a little better in 24 than we did in 23, so that's a plus.
Oh, yeah,
but
okay.
Yep. Not wasn't one of our better years either year, but I don't know. I think that I really do miss the old school days when, like, there's just so many tournaments nowadays that are just go anywhere, and, yep, you know, I feel like the camaraderie – between all the teams, like, used to, everybody knew everybody. Like, you went, and I know things grow and stuff like that, but, like, when it was just on one or two lakes, everybody stayed in the same towns. There was just so much more friendship with everybody. Now you go to these tournaments and you only know them off the internet. And I sure do miss a lot of that other. I mean, we used to always bring our families to every tournament. Everybody knew everybody. It was just, it was kind of like a vacation.
Exactly.
But now it just seems like, you know, heck, you don't know half the people, and you're like, oh yeah, I know him on Facebook or something like that, but it's not, yep, it's just not the same.
Sure.
I really do miss that part of it.
Yep. Yep. Exactly.
Yeah.
But
exactly. Yep. And I don't blame you. You know, I remember shooting in my very first Worlds down in Kentucky, you know, back in, I don't know, 2011, 2012 or whatever it was. And there's a whole bunch of us staying at these little cabin resorts right there. And they weren't the prettiest little cabins, I can tell you that. Mm-hmm. But that's where a lot of people stayed. And it was, like you said, you know, everybody
like was a family reunion.
Yeah, exactly. Yep. Exactly.
So let me ask you guys this. Would you say that not having that camaraderie that you used to have, would you make the reason for that because there's so many more people? Are there more people shooting in these tournaments than you guys remember back in the early 2010s? Are there just more people that are traveling that you guys don't necessarily know?
There's been, like, I'm referring to a lot of the Muzzy tournaments that was all down here in the South and stuff like that. And, like, they had up to 80 teams, you know, in their tournaments all. And, you know, there's not a few tournaments that have that, you know, more than that now. I mean, that's a pretty good amount of people. And yep, I remember they just always had it on one lake. I think people just like that. Now, I don't know. I've always said that Facebook and everything else kind of cut down on,
the social aspect of everything, really.
Social. Yeah.
Yeah.
It does. Yep. But I don't know. I do miss it sometimes.
Yeah, absolutely.
For sure. Yep.
And I'll kind of go off of my point of view, hosting tournaments where there's 80 to 100 boats in there, I like to see people get away from each other. Because I don't want to have people come back and say, oh, this guy was doing this and this guy was doing that, and we almost got in a fight and stuff, and I don't want that. Right. So I want them to be able to go wherever they want, you know, when we're doing our tournament. So that's why I do that. But I get both points of that. Absolutely. Absolutely get both points of views on that. The old shotgun starts. Remember the old shotgun starts, Tommy?
Oh, yeah, I do. We used to have a change of clothes every time we got to where we was going, because when it was blast off, it didn't matter what the water looked like or whatever, it was to the floorboard.
Oh, yeah, exactly. The old white knuckling down the rivers and lakes.
That had to be absolute mayhem.
It was.
Oh, my gosh.
Yeah.
It was. It was crazy. Like I said, I remember watching a few boats bounce off some channel markers on the Illinois River.
Oh, boy.
Wow. And those aren't pieces of plastic.
Right. Right.
You know?
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
Wow. Uh-huh.
The good old days. Yeah. The good old days. But so, Tommy, what was the biggest fish that you shot this past season?
Biggest fish that we shot was me and Shorty kind of smacked him at the same time, but it was in the Cajun Classic. It was a gator gar. It wound up being 7'5" and 158 pounds.
Oh, so, holy cow. Wow.
And it didn't win big fish of the tournament. Oh, we missed that by 7 pounds.
Oh, so, wow. That's crazy.
Yep. But we did win the tournament.
Well, that's good. That's
good. All that silver lining right there.
Exactly.
Yep. Cool.
Yep. I remember.
I love shooting them gator gar.
Well, I was just going to ask you about the gator gar. I remember talking to you this year at the Bass Pro U.S. Open during weigh-ins there, and you guys had that one gator gar, but the one that you were after eluded you guys, Stinty. Yeah.
We actually seen him later on in the night, but you could only shoot one.
Oh, sure.
That's right.
We kind of goosed him a little bit and kind of tried to get him back out there in the deep water so nobody would see him. But, you know, he come right back, and I'm pretty sure Andrew Cheatham got him and wound up got the big fish. I think he won the big fish on that one. I'm not 100% sure, but it was
That's right.
But it just happened to be the one that that showed up first, and we wasn't going to turn him down because, like I said, you could only shoot one, and we had only seen just a couple. So,
But you had some nice grassies though in the boat during weigh-ins there.
Yeah, I know, but we missed the mark by 10 pounds.
Oh man,
yep.
We wound up with second place on that U.S. Open this year. So
yeah.
I'm not fretting over it, but
You always have that funny feeling in your stomach, you know.
Oh yeah. I remember the ones we lose by just small amounts.
Uh-huh. Exactly.
Yeah. Stick with you.
Yeah. I believe it.
Because if we would have waited on that one gator gar and not shot that other one, then you know, there it would have been.
Right. Yep. Exactly.
Hindsight's 20/20.
Exactly. Yep. So, Tommy, let me ask you this. God forbid, if you could only bowfish one day during the entirety of the bowfishing season, what date would you choose, what state would you be in, and what species would you be targeting?
Personally, I love the gator gar. It would probably be someday in second, third week of July in Louisiana.
Oh, Louisiana.
Okay. Gotcha. Gator gar, Louisiana, favorite. Second or third week in July. Gotcha.
Yep. I love that place down there. Not sure I'd want to live there, but I truly like going there every chance we get.
Yep. Cool. Yep. Now, are they spawning at that time down there, Tommy? And would you be daytime shooting?
No.
Okay.
Either way, they'll spawn in the springtime, but it's just the water is so much more stable. The grass is usually up, and the water is clearer, and it's just makes for a better time to me. I mean, grant you, I've been down there on some good spawning trips too, but the water is usually very unstable. There's could be muddy everywhere. I mean, you're going to always find some clear water, but I don't know. It's just more of a, you can pretty much go down there and be guaranteed you're going to have a pretty decent time in that time of year as far as being able to see fish. And so I just love that time of year there.
Yep. Interesting.
Can't beat that.
Yeah.
Now let me ask you this, Tommy, when they're spawning down there, so you have your one female, like, is she surrounded by a pretty good group of males, or is it just, you know, one or two? Or she's got
If you find the right spot, it could be a whole bay of them like that.
Oh, my gosh.
Like, literally, it looks like telephone poles laying out across there.
Oh, what a visual.
Logging videos. Wow. I've only seen it that way probably maybe 4 or 5 times ever, but literally, if you see it, it's you don't forget it. It's unbelievable.
That's wild. Telephone poles. Right. That's a good visual. Wow.
I think we're going to Louisiana.
Yeah, let's go to Louisiana second or third week of July next year.
Wow. All right, Tommy. Excluding your bows, your arrows, your reels, what is the most important piece of bowfishing equipment that you use and why?
I would say Google Maps because we do a lot of scouting. But as far as in on my boat, I would say probably my Garmin. For like when we're in big flats or whatever, I can just use it to cover. You can do it in your head, but I always use that. I can look down there and see what little spot I haven't went over, and that could be where the one that you're looking for is laying. He's avoiding you, and you can't daggum keep all that in your head all the time. So I'm going to say it'll be my Garmin, the chart plotter.
Exactly. Yeah. And when Derek gave me these questions, I was reading these questions myself and stuff, and I said that same thing in my head. Sure. You know, what would it be? And that would be the Garmin.
That's what, when I wrote that question, I'm like, I bet you I know what a lot of these are going to answer.
Yep.
The old GPS.
Mm-hmm.
Yep.
And then it gets you back and forth safe and sound also.
Yep.
Mm-hmm.
Yep. That's for sure. Yeah. I mean, I love the Google Maps and everything. I kind of wish they'd just go kind of sometimes do away with that and just go back to old lake maps. I remember sitting in the bathroom looking at lake maps all the time.
Yes, exactly.
Scouting for tournaments, and now you just sit in your phone anywhere.
Yeah,
but I know Shorty still got some beside his toilet in his bathroom.
Oh, so. Yeah. Yep.
Oh,
They're waterproof and everything. The old lake maps.
Exactly.
Yes. Yep. You could hardly tear them things neither. I think they were tear-proof.
Yep, that's for sure.
I remember going on to their website, and, you know, of course, we didn't have lake maps from lakes in Kentucky or Alabama. So I would order them online and get those. Mm-hmm. And like you said, study them and look at them and see the creeks and find out where the boat landings were, because you didn't have none of that stuff on your phone.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
I've
got one in my office. It's a Fishing Hotspots is the name of the map.
Yep.
And Fishing Hotspots. It's that same kind of tear resistant, water resistant, and they are cool to look at. They're neat, but everything seems to be on the phone nowadays, or the Garmin.
Right.
So.
Oh yeah.
Mm-hmm. Cool.
Yep.
Well, Tommy, you've done a lot of bow fishing in your lifetime, but what is one trophy that you would still love to check off the old bucket list?
I don't know exactly who it is y'all are calling after you get me, but it's going to be probably, I've never killed I want to kill one of them 100-pound big heads.
Oh, okay. All right. Yep. A little foreshadowing.
Yes. I know. I remember fishing back in the day, I shot a 77 or 80-pound bigmouth buffalo here in Wisconsin.
Yep. Yep.
Mm-hmm. And I can always remember saying, there's a fish in here that's 100 pounds. Mm-hmm. There's a buffalo that's 100 pounds, you know. And I think now the state record is up to 98 pounds. And I remember saying that to Dennis years ago down there, you know. There's big heads in there that are over 100 pounds. There's got to be. They just don't come up to the surface as much as the other ones do.
Right, right.
Oh, yeah.
And, can you imagine holding a 100-pound freshwater fish?
That's crazy. Crazy.
Yep.
Oh, my goodness.
Yeah. For sure.
I mean, based off the law of averages, with the size of these fish that are getting shot, there's got to be one.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, there's got to. I would only think it's a matter of time in the upcoming years that one hits that triple-digit mark.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
Yeah.
Yep.
Yep, and then, I would say so.
And then to make it even better, it'd be an albino one, too.
Oh, boy. The double whammy. Yeah, to make it even better, Matt would shoot it.
Yeah. I think we ought to hook up this year, Tommy, and me, you, and old Mr. Redden should take a little river trip sometime, huh?
I agree. 100%. Yeah.
Heck yeah, that'd be a good time.
100%.
Yep.
But,
so, I'm pretty sure that you know what's going on with the 2025 Worlds next year. I'm sure that you've been discussing stuff with Shorty and probably Hunter and already probably game planning for what you guys might be doing next year. What do you think about the 2025 Worlds?
Yeah, it's gonna be a different one. 17 hours, isn't it? Isn't that what it is?
Yes. Yes.
Yeah, I'm 55 years old. That's going to be a long 17 hours.
Yes, sir. You better have a bunch of Red Bull ready to rock and roll on that one. Wow.
we've been scoping it out and done a little bit of talking amongst ourselves, and we really haven't come up with a complete game plan yet. We've charted out a couple places that we've targeting certain species, and it's going to be a lot of thinking in that game.
You got that right. Yes, sir.
I'm sure we'll come up with something that might not be competitive, but I hope we are.
Oh, I'm sure you will be.
Yeah.
Yep, I'm sure you will be. And it's really going to be kind of fun to see if they do any. I'm sure they will do some live streaming of the weigh-ins there.
Right.
But,
yeah.
With the variety of fish that might be coming in to weigh-ins.
It's going to be different.
Know? Right, yeah. You could see anything on this tournament.
Exactly. Exactly.
From stingrays to gator gar to hoop to whatever. I'm sure there's going to be a lot of people kind of pulling out some different straws.
You got that right. Yep, absolutely. And
that might be the thing that does it too. You can never tell.
Right, right. And kind of going back to the 2025 Worlds, to what we were first talking about when you like the old camaraderie and, you know, one lake and stuff like that there, you know, you can see where you'll have teams that don't go to the tournament headquarters until Saturday.
Right. Yeah.
You know, they're going to be staying in their home state or wherever they're going to be doing their bowfishing and stuff. So, you can see both ways on that, you know?
Yep.
You can definitely see both ways on that.
That's going to be completely different. For sure.
Yes.
We'll see how everybody, I'm anxious to see how everybody reacts to it and how, what they think about it.
Yes. It'll be interesting to see the turnout and all that stuff. Yep.
Yep. 'Cause I think it's on a Friday too, isn't it?
Yeah, it is. Yep.
Yeah.
Yep. Friday. Yep. You're going to need
a couple of tournaments that we've had that's been on a Friday just because it gives you another day to recuperate before you have to go back to reality.
And you're going to have to recuperate for this one.
Yeah.
100%.
Yep.
100%.
Yep. So, well, I think that's it, Tommy. Thank you very much for taking the time and, like I said, and chatting on here with us. I really appreciate that, and we wish you the best of luck next year on the water. I hope to see you next year somewhere. I'm sure I'll see you at the ATA show here this January.
Yep.
And good luck on the rest of your hunting down there. And
all right. Well, I appreciate it.
Yeah.
I need it.
I don't know if you do after what you just told us about Kansas there.
It's kind of different though when we go to Kansas and we come back home. It's kind of like I ain't really seen nothing on camera. I don't want to shoot.
I bet.
I hear you.
Kansas is kind of like a sleeper state.
Oh God,
you got Kansas and Kentucky and there's some studs that are shot.
Oh yeah, absolutely.
Wow.
Absolutely.
Oh yeah.
Some big fish.
For sure.
Well, Tommy, you and your family have a great Thanksgiving. And like I said, we'll see you here hopefully at the ATA show.
Appreciate it, Tommy.
All right. Sounds good, bud. Thanks, Tom. Y'all take care.
You too. Bye-bye.
Old Tommy Woods.
Yeah.
Always full of good information.
Oh, yeah.
That's cool. Yep. I didn't know what I was expecting him to say, but the 100-pound big head, that was a little bit of a surprise to me, to be honest with you. I thought he was going to say some gigantic-sized gator gar was going to be my guess, just based off of the theme of what else he was talking about.
I think he's done the gator gar stuff so much that, you know, now it's time to go chase something different.
Yep, a new challenge.
Yeah.
Yeah, triple digits. Mm-hmm. That's crazy. But well, I tell you what, Matt, let's move on to our next person that we're going to give a call here. And I believe that is going to be our old buddy, Dennis Redden.
DR, buddy.
Down there in Kentucky. All right, let's give Dennis a call here.
All right, let's do her. All right, so now we've got our good buddy from Kentucky.
Yes, sir.
Mr. Dennis Redden. How you doing, Dennis?
I'm doing fine, guys. Doing fine.
Awesome.
Good deal.
How's the fall been treating you down there, Dennis? What kind of weather you been having, too?
Well, today it's like 74, 75 degrees.
Wow.
You know, it set a record yesterday for the warmest day.
Oh, my gosh.
On this date. So, not real good for deer hunting,
no.
But we're killing a few, you know. Dad, he killed his couple, and my granddaughter got hers, day before yesterday. So, you know, we're doing okay.
Awesome.
Gotcha. That's very cool.
Now, did your rifle season start already down there, didn't it?
Yes. This is the second week of our rifle season.
Gotcha. Okay. All right. Gotcha. So your rifle season down there is 2 weeks long than Dennis?
Yeah, we've got till next Monday, so actually a little over 2 weeks.
Wow, that's crazy. Our starts Saturday. It's 9 days long. I think that's 9 days too long.
But then you got 9 days of muzzleloader.
Muzzleloader as well, yep.
Yeah, it's us bow hunters don't like it, but, you know, we can't do much about that.
I could tell that in your voice when you're like,
Yeah, it's here.
But it is what it is, you know. So it's just it's supposed to turn cold tonight. A big cold front coming through, so that'll help get the temperature back down to normal.
Yep, sure. Now here in Wisconsin, we can still bow hunt during the rifle season. Can you do that down there, Dennis?
Yeah, yes, we can.
All right. Gotcha.
The first week I had clients because I still got a few deer hunters, you know.
Oh, okay.
That took me out of the hunting, but I can hunt now. So as quick as this weather cools up, I'll be back in the stand.
Gotcha. Well, good luck to you on the rest of your bow hunt, Donner, Dennis.
Yeah, absolutely. Mm-hmm. Absolutely. Thank you, sir. Yeah. So what we're doing here, Dennis, we're giving a couple people a call here. And we're just running you guys through like a quick circuit, kind of like a year in review of the 2024 season. So my first question to you, Dennis, is compared to the 2023 season, would you say bowfishing was better or worse in 2024 and why?
Okay. I would say it wasn't hardly as good for me, for my personal fishing, for my guiding, my clients, it was probably better.
Okay. Yep. Gotcha. Yep.
The silvers have just exploded down here.
Wow.
And that's where I make my living on silvers.
Sure. Yep.
And there, I had an extremely good year, you know, shooting silvers. And that's what most of my clients want. They want a lot of shooting, a lot of fish. And the silver population is up, way up.
Yep.
The big heads, I think the silvers are kind of choking them out. We're getting some bigger big heads, but just not near as many as we was last year or 5 years ago.
Gotcha. So, Dennis, on an average night, if somebody wants to book a trip with Redden Outfitters, they go out shooting some fish. I mean, how many fish are you talking that these people, these clients of yours are going to get an opportunity at? I mean, how many times are they going to be shooting at these silvers that are so plentiful down there?
I get that question a lot. And on an average night, 5 hour trip, they'll shoot a couple hundred times a pick.
You can't beat that.
That's hard to beat.
You can't beat that.
No. I say, you know, I have more trouble with people having blisters on their fingers and stuff like that. Right. You know, it's just unlimited targets. Usually,
sure. Yeah. You know? Yep. Yep. That's good. That's what they come for. And that's what you're known for. I mean, that's why you have so many repeat clients. You know.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
And but the big heads is nothing like they used to be.
Yeah.
You know, used to, I could pretty well put you on a 40-pound big head about every night.
Wow.
Now, I probably didn't kill over 4 or 5 40-pound big heads.
Wow. Isn't that something?
My client.
When did you see that start to change, Dennis, that big head population dwindling and these silvers taking over? What do you have a year in mind or when that kind of started to happen?
It's been for the last 2 or 3.
Okay.
It just gradually gets worse on the river. Now, the lake fish, they're getting more of them, but, you know, we've got probably 15 commercial netters that's netting the lake.
Wow.
So they're keeping the silver population down.
Yeah.
Not down, but at least it's not growing like it is on the river.
Sure.
You know.
Sure. Yep.
People just can't believe how many. If they seen what I seen, it'd scare them. Then, you know, on a good night when the silvers are up, it's millions of them.
Wow.
Just millions.
Wow.
Basically.
That's crazy.
It's just getting them up on top where you can see them is the only trouble we have. And usually it's not that bad.
Sure. Wow. Yep.
I remember, Dennis, the first time that I went bow fishing with you was with Cindy and Jeff back in 2009 or 10, somewhere around there.
Yeah, about 15 years ago. Yep. Well, that's about right.
And I remember going down below the dams there and going down to tailwaters. And I was filming Cindy and Jeff, and you and Jeremiah were in your boat and stuff. And we went down that under the bridges down there and stuff, and we started spotting for fish. And every fish that we saw was a big head.
Yeah.
Occasionally you saw a silver, but the silver was tiny. He was just a little, you know, 7 pounders.
Really?
So he wasn't very big at all.
Wow.
7, 8 pounds, 6 pounds. But every fish that you spotted was a big head.
Sure.
you know.
That's right. Crazy. And it has some size to it, too.
Yeah, yep. And now you and I go out there, we do the same thing, same areas, and it's all silvers. And they're good-sized silvers, too, you know.
Oh, I know I remember one instance this year that we killed a silver, and they couldn't believe the size, and I actually put it on the scale, and it weighed 31 pounds.
Oh, my gosh. Yes. Wow.
That's a pretty good size silver.
Yeah.
And that was, you know.
Yeah.
Finding a 30-pound silver every night is not that hard anymore.
Wow. Isn't that crazy?
It's wild.
It is. Mm-hmm. It is. But they're mm-hmm. just so much, they're more proficient than the big heads, and they're out survival.
Right.
That's what they're doing.
Right. Do you think that they're chasing the big heads out of that area or just dwindling them out?
I don't know that the pressure would hurt them that bad. It's got to some extent because everybody, all you locals around here, that's all they want to shoot is big heads. Yeah. They don't want to shoot the silvers. Right. They're looking for big heads. So the big heads do get targeted a lot more. And when you take that plus the silvers choking them out,
yeah,
it's just not good for the big heads.
Sure,
you know?
Sure, sure. So I got to ask you, Dennis, because I don't even think I know the question to this answer. But what was the biggest fish that you shot this year?
It would have been a 68-pound buffalo.
Oh,
nice.
Wow.
Nice.
Wow, maybe I didn't know about that.
Oh, okay.
Maybe I did.
it was me and my grandson. I think we had a 68 and a 64 or something. I can't remember. You know, we had a good day. We had probably four fish over 50.
Oh, wow. That day. Yeah, that's awesome.
Yep, and that was Cody, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Uh-huh.
Yep. Now I remember those pictures now. Yep.
Gotcha.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, there's you know me, that's my first love.
Yes.
Little big fat girl.
Yep. So that Dennis is actually going to roll right into our next question here. You're just talking about shooting those big buffs, but so, God forbid, you could only bowfish one day during the entirety of a bowfishing season. What date would you choose? What state would you be in? And what species would you be targeting?
Hmm.
I wonder.
It'd be April the 5th.
Oh.
It'd be in Kentucky. Oh. And it'd be chasing them big buffalo.
Yeah. All right. That's what we figured.
I keep saying it. And everybody teases me every spring, you know, we're going to beat your record, And I'm like, she's out there somewhere.
Yeah.
There's a 100-pound fish because, you know, the commercial fisherman there now and he gets one. But that's my goal is to shoot a triple-digit fish, and I think it'll be a buffalo when I do it, if I ever do it.
Sure. Yep.
That is so
– we just talked about this with
interesting,
Tommy.
Interesting, Dennis. Because – we were talking with Tommy Woods before you were on here, and he said one of his goals would be to shoot a 100-pound big head.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And I said when I shot my big Wisconsin buff here, the big mouth, that I said, I know there's a 100-pound buff up here.
Yeah.
And then mm-hmm. 5 years later, a guy shoots a 98-pounder, you know.
That's close, isn't it?
Yeah, it is. And then for you to say that, but yeah, I was like with you on that 100-pound freshwater fish.
Wild. Triple digits.
Whoa.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. They're there. I'm telling you, they're there. And there's a 100-pound big head because they,
oh, yeah.
You know,
yeah.
They shot bigger than that. And don't get me wrong, that would be right up there, number two,
right.
Bumping the, that.
Uh-huh.
But if I just had one, it would be, of course, you know, I've been shooting buffalo for 50 years. And, you know, it's just hard to go away from what's been so good to you and what you know
right.
a lot about.
Mm-hmm. Right. Mm-hmm. I think that's something, too, that the general public does not realize how big some of these fish that bowfishermen are targeting.
A lot of them don't.
They don't have a clue. We'll post a picture on social media of a 35-pound buff, and we'll have some people that somehow, some way saw it that aren't in the bowfishing realm, and they'll be like, what is that? Mm-hmm. Where did you shoot it?
Mm-hmm.
It's like, oh, we shot on a very highly developed lake here in Wisconsin. Like, they're,
right.
And they get twice this size easily.
Yeah.
It's just the general public doesn't realize how big these fish can get.
They don't. Nope. I remember.
And it's funny because our big buff don't show up except in the spawn. And now where they go the rest of the year is a good question.
Mm-hmm.
But literally, we was passing up 50-pound buffalo trying to look for that big buffalo this spring.
Mm-hmm.
It's and you don't do that any other time of the year. Cause,
right.
You know, in the summertime, a 40-pound buff, they're a really good buff.
Right.
Mm-hmm. And in the spawn, she gets a free pass. Let her go.
Right.
That's crazy. Funny. Crazy. And I just happened to be extremely lucky back in 2016 to be on the boat with you, Dennis, when the buffs were in there really good. You know, we shot some we shot some big fish.
Yeah.
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 You know, and that's when you shot your record that some guy knocked you out of. I don't know who it was.
I don't know who that guy was.
Yeah. Yep. Yep.
And then, of course, Jeremiah, he's got the black buffalo. You know, his is 84.
Yep.
So I've been lucky, real lucky, and been able to get on some big buffalo.
That's cool. Yeah, that's cool. Awesome. Very cool.
Well, Dennis, excluding your bows, your arrows, and your reels, what is the most important piece of bowfishing equipment that you use, and why?
Well, there would be no doubt about that. It would be my light. You know, I use the AMS spec light. I've got several of them.
Mm-hmm.
I keep a spare in my bow case. I've got one on my bow. I keep two that I use for my clients. I use them every night.
Wow.
You know.
Okay. Yeah.
That everybody's always calling me. You know, I've had trouble with this switch, and I've got some aftermarket lights, and mm-hmm. I tell them, night in, night out, the AMS is the most dependable, because that's what I have to have. You know, if I've got clients that drove 6-8 hours to shoot, they don't want to hear me like, "Oh, well, my light's not working. I got to change or got to work on it."
Right. Yeah.
So I use it every night. And when I'm bow fishing, that's what I got on too. So
that's awesome.
It'd be hands down, it would be my AMS spec light. You know, it's part of my equipment.
Gotcha.
I couldn't do it.
Yep.
That's cool.
And in that situation, that's something that you use hours and hours on end.
Yes.
Night after night after night.
Right.
And it's the durability of the on off, because it's constant on off, on off, mm-hmm. on off.
Yes.
All night for 5 hours.
Yeah.
Right.
Yep.
Right.
Yep. That's mm-hmm. cool. That's mm-hmm. I didn't know what he was going to answer there. I like that. That's cool.
I wasn't expecting to. I didn't know what he was going to say
yep.
either.
Yep.
That makes a lot of sense for what you're doing.
Right.
For what I'm doing, you know, and I, you know, your GPS is that, you know, they're handy and you need them too, and the boat and everything else, but I couldn't do without my life.
Gotcha.
Very cool.
Yep. Yeah. Awesome. That's good awesome. Answer. Good yep. answer. Good mm-hmm. answer. So, last question here for you, Dennis. You've shot a lot of tournaments in your day, done a lot of bow fishing. What are your thoughts on the 2025 Worlds in Alabama?
They've changed the menu a lot. I don't know how that's all going to go over. Mm-hmm. I'm afraid they're taking the little guy out of it, or John Doe that's got a little 14-foot boat that likes to bow fish.
Sure. Yep.
It's not in his advantage, I don't think, what they're doing and allowing anything that's legal to shoot. You know what I'm saying?
Yep. Yep. I hear you. Yep.
Mm-hmm. You know, it's just, if you think about it, I mean, you take a boat like that and you put him up against Tommy Woods down south, it's the odds are stacked against him,
mm-hmm.
you know.
Mm-hmm.
And that would be my only thought. I mean, other than that, you know, and I get where they're coming from, that, you know, whatever's legal and they're giving you extra time, that's good. That's going to put a lot of people on the road when they ain't had no sleep.
Oh.
You know, I kind of worry about that a little.
Sure.
Because you know how bow fishermen are.
Yeah.
If they've got the time, they don't think nothing about driving 6 hours, shooting 10 hours, and driving 6 hours back when they ain't had no sleep.
Yeah. 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 Yep. I hear you.
But I guess as I get older, I worry more stuff about stuff like that than I used to, because right. we used to do the same thing. Right. But it's, you know what I'm saying? It gets mm-hmm. to a point where, you know, I don't know if it's smart to give them that much time or not.
Yeah, right. Those are good points, Dennis. I totally hear you on those.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. Yeah. Absolutely.
But other than taking the smaller boat at a disadvantage, you know, that would be my biggest concern yeah. there. Because, you know, we've got, y'all have them up there, we do here, we've got tons of little 14, 16-foot boats that mm-hmm. bowfish.
Yep. Mm-hmm.
And
yep.
They want to compete because, you know, a lot of times they save up their money all year just so they can compete in a big tournament. Sure, like
right.
that.
Yep. Yep. Mm-hmm. Yep.
Mm-hmm.
But anyhow, that's my 2 cents worth
sure.
on that. You know,
yep.
Everybody's got their opinions. And so
mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
that's kind of where I was at on that.
Gotcha. Cool.
Yep. Well, Dennis, we really appreciate you taking the time out of your day today and joining us here and chatting with us here on the Bowfishing Buzz. And, we'll let you get back to what you're doing, and we wish you and your family a happy Thanksgiving, and I'm sure I'll see you next year somewhere on the water.
I sure say, you know, we're about to get this cabin done, so you'll have a new place to stay when you come down.
And nice.
You know when that you know when that spawn's going to roll around.
That's right. That's right.
mm-hmm.
All it's right. good talking to you guys, boy. Yeah. I appreciate it.
You too, Dennis, and good luck the rest of your archery hunts here.
Thank you, sir. See All you right. there.
Yep, see you we'll see you, Dennis. Thank you.
Uh-huh. Bye-bye.
Bye.
Two interesting takeaways there, Matt.
Yes.
One, the Spec Ops light for a guy like that that's guiding every single night.
Every
He's
night.
Got people, like he said, depending on him that are driving 6 to 8 hours away. That light is so important
right.
to him. I didn't connect those dots before, but absolutely, that's something he can't go without.
Exactly.
That's awesome. Mm-hmm. That's very cool. And two, some good points made about Worlds as far as that layout goes and everything. That's just a side of it that we haven't necessarily heard from anybody
right.
before. So
right.
cool info from old mm-hmm. Mr. Dennis Redden
mm-hmm.
down there.
Mm-hmm. And next we're going to be giving Lance Brantley a call.
Yes, sir.
And I'm sure he's very busy this time of year because Lance, his big business down there is the tracking. We had him on last year talking about his tracking business there for
yep.
deer and stuff,
yep.
his dogs and stuff. And that's actually the team of his name is On Track.
On Track.
Bowfishing.
Yep. Yep.
And so next up, we're going to be giving Lance Brantley a call.
All right. Sounds good. Let's ask some questions.
Yes. Lance, how the heck you doing today?
I'm doing good, buddy. Doing good. How
that's
about you
awesome.
Guys?
That's awesome. We're doing great.
Mm-hmm. Yes,
we're doing great. I got to ask you because it's a season, Lance. Are you running on and putting a lot of miles with your dog chasing people's deer around or trying to find their deer, I should say?
Oh, we're not cutting them no slack, that's for sure.
I believe it.
All day yesterday into the night, and I took the night off and went back at it again today.
No kidding.
Wow. Yeah, wow. Busy time of year for you, Lance. But you've had a little bit of time to get out and do some deer hunting yourself, is that correct?
I took time this year.
Wow.
Been 4 years since I got to hunt myself, and I said I'm going to take a week or so and see if I can't get on something.
Well, you didn't mess around and take any time on shooting something pretty awesome.
Yeah.
My goodness, you shot a heck of a buck down there. Congratulations.
Well, thank you. I was blessed. It all worked out. You know how it is. A lot of times it don't, but this time it did.
Wow.
Cool.
Nice. That was a heck of a deer.
Yeah, it was.
Heck of a deer.
It was a stud.
My goodness.
Yeah.
Did you know of that deer, or did you have pictures of that deer? Or?
Yeah. I started running trail camera just trying to find a deer to target.
Okay.
And I got him at night and had him for a few weeks, never could get him to daylight, and had to kind of reposition things a couple of times, and finally got eyes on him in daytime. And the day the first time I seen him, he was probably 150 yards, never got a shot. And the following day he made a mistake and hit the wrong trail.
No kidding.
Hmm.
Wow.
Awesome.
Now, is that on public land or is that private lands?
That's a small, private piece.
Gotcha. Okay. Cool. All right. Did you need the help of your dog?
I didn't. I actually heart shot that one.
Nice.
I didn't need him. I thought I may have, When I first made the shot, I didn't hear the normal thump, and
yep.
it kind of made me nervous. I thought, oh man, I don't know. But I got down and found my arrow and felt good about everything after that. And
awesome.
Just went ahead and left, gave it an hour, came back, and he hadn't gone 50 yards.
That's very cool. That's awesome. You know, on that dog topic there, have you had any crazy tracks so far this year, Lance?
I mean, nothing just crazy out of the ordinary, but we definitely had a lot of adventures, I say that.
Yeah, yep. What's the biggest one you found so far this year?
I want to say it was in the 90s, wow. 192, if I'm not mistaken.
Oh, God. Jeez.
That was a deer from northern Kentucky area.
My goodness.
Wow, that's wild. Yeah. A lot of these guests we're having on today have experienced some very large deer so far this year. Yeah. My goodness.
Tommy Woods was telling us he just got back from hunting up in Kansas, and they shot a 190 and a 170 and a couple 150s. I'm like, good grief.
Yeah, six out of the seven in their party shot studs.
Hey, even Tommy had to give me a call down there in Kansas. He gave me a call, and actually one of those deer, my buddy had to locate with a drone for him.
Oh, no kidding.
Tommy's, I think, yes, sir. I think Tommy's, they didn't have no problem with his, but, you know, when you make that shot, he sent me pictures of arrows and just trying to think, make sure everything was what he thought, and I think it worked out for him pretty good.
Cool. That's cool. Yeah, that's cool. Awesome. So, I mean, how cool is that? I mean, you guys are competing against each other on the water and in the tournaments and stuff like that there, and you create this friendship, you know? You create this bond of friendships with people that you see on the water in the bowfish community, and then they're, you know, you're calling each other during hunting season and helping each other out. That's really cool. That's pretty cool.
Yeah, but you got to watch them boys though, Matthew. they're tricky. They're slick like that.
They're tricky.
I sent my drone guy down there, and first thing I told him, because I take you bow fishing some, I said Shorty's going to ask you something about a big head. You just don't tell him nothing. Tell him below bark. All he needs to know is below Barkley Dam.
Oh, it's too
funny. Sure enough, they's out there flying that drone, and Shorty said, Alan, does Lance ever take you on the, you know, bow fishing any? And he said, yeah. He said, yeah, he takes me below Barkley Dam. He said, how did I know you were going to say that?
Perfect. Wow.
That's awesome.
That's good.
That is good stuff right
you
there.
You saw that coming a mile away.
Yeah, Shorty's just going to kind of ease into it, too. You got to watch him, fellas.
Yep.
That's good stuff right there.
Yeah. So what we're going to do here, Lance, we've got a couple questions for you. We've given a couple guys a call here. It's just kind of like a quick circuit of questions about your 2024 season. First question for you, Lance. Compared to the 2023 bowfishing season, would you say that bowfishing was better or worse in 2024, and why?
I mean, that's a hard question, because we were blessed with a good season in 23. 24, we had a good run also. Mm-hmm. I mean, I want to say because, you know, we were blessed enough to win the Worlds, which the Open was a big one for us also. Don't get me wrong. But last year, I want to say overall, I mean, 23 was an exciting year. That would probably be my favorite season.
Okay.
I mean, we just, you know, we brought Gunner aboard and everybody started jiving well. And, you know, our scouting and everything just, you know, it ran over into 24. But if I had to pick a year, I want to say 23.
Cool.
Okay. Gotcha. Mm-hmm. Gotcha.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So I have to ask you, I'm sure a lot of our listeners want to know, what is the biggest fish that you have shot this past season?
I mean, I we don't shoot many fish when we're scouting, so it's mainly tournament fish.
Yep.
The fish I'm going to claim, I had an arrow in. I mean, I didn't shoot it by myself. It probably had another arrow in it with my team, but I'm going to say it was somewhere in the 80s. 85-ish, and that's probably be the best one that I put early.
Jeez. Oh, my gosh. Wow.
Mm.
Wow.
That's a stud.
Yeah, big old big hit.
Now Gunner shot that, which I'm proud for him. He shot that one, I think it was a little over 90, when we were scouting for the Muzzy, and I think that took the Mississippi State record. We was proud of that as
right.
a team.
Right. Wow. Not only does Lance shoot big fish, he shoots big bucks.
Yeah, he's just a big killer.
Oh, all my around. Goodness.
Yep. Yep.
I gotta have big targets, Matt. That's why I got a track dog. I'm not a very good shot.
Right. There you go. Yep. Yep. Oh, that's too funny.
Goodness gracious.
Well, I'll tell you what, Lance. God forbid you could only bowfish one day during the entirety of a bowfishing season. What date would you choose? What state would you be in? And what species of fish would you be targeting?
I'm going to say, I mean, one of my favorite is chasing spawning buffalo. So, okay. I mean, of course, that, you know, those days change a little bit, but I would say April 5th in Kentucky would wow. be pretty close.
You wow. are you are within one day of what Dennis's answer was. That's funny.
Oh, my day's right. Then he's wrong. Oh,
okay.
That's good stuff that right is. There, too,
wow.
man. Wow. That's awesome.
That's awesome. Funny. He said that.
Now, okay, Lance, so excluding your bows, your arrows, and your reels, what is the most important piece of bowfishing equipment that you use and why?
I'm pretty particular about the light. I mean, that's, yep. you know, we're mainly bow lighters and mm-hmm. it does matter. And I do, I mean, I'm a fan of the special ops, being able to adjust the, you know, your brightness means a lot at times. Mm-hmm. And I mean, just penetrating the water. I mean, we don't really run nothing but bow lights 90% of the time. So that's definitely yep. probably one of the most picky sure. I'm about. Anyhow. Sure.
Okay. Yep. How crazy is it that you and Dennis were within one day of your date, and you had the same answer for that question.
Y'all need to call Dennis second next time.
Yeah. I was oh, that's good. That's good. Well, Lance, you've done a lot of bowfishing in your lifetime, obviously. What is one trophy that you would still love to check off the old bucket list?
I'd like to shoot a gator grower. That's something I haven't got to experience okay. or chase, and I think that'd be a good time.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Nothing like having a gator grind into the line and that tug and that pull,
yeah.
you know?
Yeah.
I guess it might be the same thing as a 80-some-pound big head, too. You know, they tug and pull pretty mm-hmm. hard. But yeah, the length on those gator guards, you know, that, you know, it's 6 footers, 6.5 foot, you know, and stuff like that is yeah. just impressive.
Yeah.
Wild. Mm-hmm.
And they're just a cool fish, you know? I mean, yeah. they look like a daggum alligator. That's just pretty neat.
Right. Yep. So, Lance, 2025 Worlds, you and your teammates been discussing anything about that at all yet for next season?
Sure, we're always talking, you know, but you know how it is, long ways off, and mm-hmm. more or less just kind of planning for vacations and stuff like that. But, yeah, I mean, we're looking forward to it. You know, it's always exciting, and especially this is, you know, being – where it is, it's not too far out of reach, you know. Mm-hmm. There's going to be some familiar water involved, we think, and we're mm-hmm. excited about it. It's mm-hmm. definitely nerve-wracking when these big tournaments show up and kind of in your ballpark that you can go and shoot. So it's
right.
It's exciting.
Cool. I'm glad you guys are looking forward to that.
Yeah.
And like I said, I'm sure you guys have kind of talked amongst each other of starting to put a little bit of a game plan together, what you first moves should start to be once mm-hmm. it gets closer and stuff like that there. So yeah, it'll be interesting to watch the weigh-ins on
yeah.
on that Saturday morning, because you know, the tournament's on Friday now, so that's going to be a little
I mean, it's a different tournament. I mean, the last I heard, I mean, far as they were opening up to the stingrays, to the yeah. saltwater, freshwater, I mean, that's right. You know, it's mm-hmm. nerve-wracking, too, because you don't know what your competition's going to be. You know, typically we try to figure out what average we're looking to try to beat or be competitive against. And this yeah. one here, I don't have a clue.
Right.
It's going to be interesting.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, definitely a certain mystique to the whole thing this year.
Right.
Yeah. Never know yep. what you're going to see at weigh-ins.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
We might pull up with a salt life sticker on the boat.
There you go. Uh-huh. There you go,
yep.
buddy.
Yep.
Go down and get you one of them gator guard that you're going to want to get right there.
Oh, man.
That's good stuff right there. Well, Lance, we want to thank you for taking the time to join us and just chat with us here a little bit about some of these questions here that we had for you. And I know you're busy. You just got done telling us before we had you live on the phone here that you were out doing some tracking and you're heading back home now. So really appreciate you taking the time and joining us here today on the Bowfishing Buzz, Lance.
Yeah, thanks, Lance.
Thank you, guys. Y'all have a good day.
Yeah, you too, and good luck down there with your tracking and stuff.
Sounds good, man. I'll All be right. talking to you guys.
You bet. Take care, Lance. Bye-bye.
We'll see you, Lance.
Yes, sir.
Another stuff as usual.
Another checkmark in the old Spec Ops column.
Yeah.
That's funny.
Yep, those big head hunters like them.
Yep. Yep. I was thinking that all three of these guys were going to say their Garmin unit or their GPS unit. And Tommy started that with the first call. I'm like, oh, we're going to go 3 for 3 with these. But no, we got two that I wasn't expecting. But Makes total sense.
Right.
Makes total sense.
That's good stuff right there.
Oh, I know what that means. All right. Let's see what we got today.
Get ready for fish that you wish.
All right. This fish that you wish comes to us out of a state that had the first umbrella factory in the United States back in 1828. Renowned poet Edgar Allan Poe is buried in the state, and the NFL team is named after one of his poems, The Raven.
Oh.
I'm talking Maryland. This fish was shot on May 24th, 2018, by Alex Fox.
Ooh.
With a length of 36.5 inches, this northern snakehead tipped the scales at a hefty 19.9 pounds.
What a tank. What a tank.
And that's a fish you wish you shot.
Way to tie in the northern snakehead together there, Matt. I should have been expecting that. That was pretty good. That was pretty good. Side note, I did not know that the ravens were named after an Edgar Allan Poe poem.
Yeah, how cool is that?
Yeah, I did not know that.
See, it's also, not only is the bowfishing buzz about outdoors and bowfishing and bow hunting and big bucks and big deer, little of science in there too, a little history.
We're huge on poetry here at the bowfishing buzz. 100%. 100%. I tell you what, Matt, speaking of poetry, I got something that our listeners might want to, they're going to enjoy listening to this. So
bring it on.
As everybody knows, Thanksgiving right around the corner.
Yes.
And Matt, what is the day after Thanksgiving? What is that day?
Black Friday.
We go and we spend time with our family and we talk about all the things that we're thankful for. And then the next day, we're shoulder to shoulder pushing people in stores, trying to get a good deal on something. Yeah. Yes, absolutely. As a thank you to all of our listeners here on the Bowfishing Buzz, Matt, we are going to give you guys a week of early access to our Black Friday specials.
Nice.
All right. Let me run you guys through what we all got here. Wow. All of our Yeti selections, you can see them here. Matt's got the Megamouth one. I've got the AMS option here. We have 20-ounce Ramblers, 30-ounce Ramblers, 30-ounce Ramblers that is a travel mug, and a 36-ounce Rambler bottle. All of those are going to be 25% off. They're already very well-priced retail price, so 25% off all of our Yetis. We're also going to have a Southpaw special. I'm talking left hand.
Real Southpaws.
Yes. Left hand hooligans, bare bow hooligans, $350 for a bare bow.
Oh my gosh, you old V2s?
Yes, absolutely.
Oh.
Black Friday specials for those left handed hooligans. We also have both the Megamouth and AMS bow cases. I know from the Megamouth side of things, we sell a ton of these bow cases because we specially tailored them to fit any bow with the Megamouth reel mounted to it. You do not have to take that off. Traditional bow cases are not wide enough that you know that the torque rod sticks out the front
of it. Yeah.
Yes. So those are on sale from $130 down to $99.
Oh my goodness!
Absolutely. Also, $24.99 for our brand new Megamouth and AMS hooded UV resistant jerseys.
Wow.
Yes. Some wicked deals going on here.
Jerseys are bad.
They're awesome. They're awesome. And my favorite aspect of them is that deep hood. Because you can have that protect from the sun during daytime shooting, protect from the bugs at night. They're perfect. Absolutely. Breathable, protect you from the sun.
They're slick.
So we've got all those specials going. But because it is so early that we're offering this Black Friday special, these Cyber Monday specials to you guys, we don't even have the codes made on the website yet. If you guys want to take advantage of these deals, all you've got to do is send us a direct message on Facebook or Instagram. Shoot us an email at sales@amsbowfishing.com or sales@megamouthbowfishing.com or give us a call, 888-541-7657. Just say that you heard about these Black Friday specials listening to our podcast
right here,
and we will make you up a custom order for once in a... You won't see these prices at all anymore throughout the year. Maybe next Black Friday, but I don't even know if we're going to have these type of sales next year. So give us a call, shoot us a message, send us an email, and take advantage of some early offer Yep. Thank you to the listener specials
yes.
for Black Friday.
Only for our Bowfishing Buzz podcast exactly. listeners.
Exclusive. Exclusive. Baby. Absolutely.
Nice. Nice. Well, Schmitty, you know, usually we have our outro song that mm-hmm. we always play.
Yeah. Well, I don't know if I like where this is
going. I'm gonna go back in history here a little bit, and this is going to be an outro for this one because it's a special one.
I wonder what it is. Oh, of course.
When I start back in the boating, I'm not there to fish. I'm there to bowfish. Oh, yeah. That's what I be doing.
I'm there to bowfish. I hate how catchy it is.
A bowfish to the east. A bowfish to the west. So from all of us here at AMS Bowfishing and
Megamouth Bowfishing as well,
we wish you the best of luck on the water. We hope you have a great Thanksgiving.
Absolutely. Yep.
Enjoy the time with family and friends. That's what it's all about. And like I said, we wish you all the best of luck. And remember, aim low,
think big. Thanks for listening, guys.
Have you ever bowfished while the carp were spawning?
Oh, let's turn that baby up a little bit. There you go.
Well, let me ask you this, D. Schmitty. Have you ever been a BAA World Champ?
No.
I didn't think so.